Evening, everybody. Hey, I'm just going to respond to Jay's video, passing on a skill. This one's pretty useless, but I took some time out from making my own matches to do this. As you know, I'm a real-world pilot, but most of my flying these days is done in simulations. These are not games. these are simulations. This is some of the gear that I use in these. So you see the rudder pedals there, as well as the stick and the throttle quadrant there with the clickable pots and switches, as well as the throttle there. These are multifunction displays. You'll see one on either side of the monitor there. And this is a track IR system. This tracks head movement. It tracks this reflective cap there. Translates those head movements into the game. So if I lean or roll or move either way, it will reflect that in game. This is the A-10. This is a procedural simulator for the A-10 Alpha to the Charlie model, and there's the A-10, commonly known as the Warthog or the Tank Killer. This is the cockpit. You can see every gauge, button, anything is clickable in this cockpit, and everything is fully real. There's the ailerons and the speed brakes there, and you can see the engine spooling up. Well, the spool-up time on this, the startup time, is about 25 minutes from the time you start to the time you're ready to taxi, so I spared you that. Decided to just kind of move things along a little bit. And here we are taxiing. A little different paint scheme here, and I'll just kind of walk you through this this video. At the end of it, you should be able to take off and land your own A-10, should you find yourself in one. And you can see that giant 30mm cannon underneath the nose. Here we are on the runway and getting ready to go. Just doing some final checks here. And looking over the engine instruments. And we'll go ahead and get the radio turned off there so you don't have to listen to that. There we go. And here we're lined up on runway 27. The numbers at the end of the runway indicate runway heading. So 27 is 270, it's facing west. Gonna bring up the engines to 90% and get ready to come off the brakes. There we go. And we're off. All right, we'll go ahead and take the takeoff there. And here we are going to be establishing a downwind that is parallel to the runway. Downwind position to land. There's the runway we just took off from. Go ahead and throw in some speed brake. There they are coming out. And we're flying level at this point, about 2,500 feet, about 190 knots, 180 knots now. So we'll go ahead and get in landing configuration, that is with gear down, and ready to go. Here we are turning base. So gears down, flaps are down, and we're going to turn this base leg and roll out onto final. Now in a slow flight configuration such as this, the throttle or power is actually controlling your rate of descent, and the pitch, the up and down motion of the plane, is controlling your airspeed. So if you want to slow down, you pitch the nose up. If you want to arrest your descent, you add a little power. The circle in the middle of the HUD, the heads-up display there, is the VVI or TVI, the total velocity indicator or velocity vector indicator, and shows you where your plane is heading. And for a standard landing in this aircraft, about a 3-degree glide slope or rate of descent. That bottom ladder there is 5 degrees, so we're just a little bit too fast on the descent, and you'll see we correct that here. And there's what is known as Bitchin' Betty. She lets you know if you get too low. So we're maintaining center line on the runway, maintaining our descent, maintaining the airspeed, and we'll transition here in just a second to the flare. The flare is where you'll bring the nose high. That will slow down the aircraft significantly and arrest the rate of descent so that you can touch down smoothly and softly. And coming over the runway threshold, we're going to go ahead and decrease the throttle, pitch the nose up, and you'll see that there, a nose-high attitude on landing. And there we'll got it stopped. We're retracting the speed brakes. And we'll turn a taxi now. So we'll start back taxiing. So there you have it. Now you know how to land the A10. Hope I didn't skimp on any details. Let's try something a little older, something with a prop. This is a Spitfire World War II aircraft flown by the British. And we're over Dover. We're going to simulate some slow flight and a stall. A stall is a condition in which there's not sufficient airflow over the wings to support flight. And a spin is where one wing basically stalls and the other one continues flying around it. Here we go, get a little buffet, and just a little pre-stall warning, and here we go into the spin. So I'm holding a little rudder, and what's happening here is the left wing is trying to fly around the stalled right wing. You can see that there. In the real world, you lose somewhere between 300 and 500 feet per rotation. And it can be quite terrifying. These can happen during takeoff or landing, anytime the plane is in slow flight, if it gets uncoordinated. And now we've come out of that and recovered. And same principles landing a propeller-driven aircraft as there are landing a jet. Again, in slow flight, your power or throttle controls your rate of descent, whereas the pitch controls the airspeed. And there's some flaps coming up. You'll see the plane balloon up just a little bit due to the added lift. And again, we'll go ahead and turn onto a base. Now, this is a traditional geared aircraft, meaning the two main gears, wheels, are located under the wing. On either side of the wing, and there is a tail wheel located at the very rear of the aircraft. That means that in a landing, this plane will be in a nose-high attitude, so it's difficult to see what's going on in front of you. So we have to look kind of to the side to judge our descent and touchdown point. Get a little crosswind here to deal with. And so we'll land with one wing slightly down, and there we go. So that got the aircraft on the ground. And here's some bombers overflying us, and with some bombs falling. So we gotta go. Obviously, gotta go get those guys. And here we are in trail of one of those bombers that you just saw a moment ago, and we're gonna start seeing if we can pick this apart. Now, most of these have rear gunners, so it's pretty dangerous tracking directly from the rear. And you'll see us start aiming for engines. There's not much. It's got a pretty thin profile from the rear here. So you'll see us try and land direct hits on engines. You see some pieces falling out there. It looks like a couple of engine hits with some fuel streaming out. A little secondary explosion a moment ago, so I think that right engine's hurt. And let's just take a look at what sort of damage we did to this guy. Yeah, you see the fuel streaming out of both engines, so not going to last long. Probably not going to make it across the channel. And let's slide underneath here and see what we can see. You probably see some bullet holes underneath there. Yep. Just under the fuselage. Probably a couple of dead gunners in there too. And the aileron on the left side's gone. So the plane's in pretty bad shape. So there you go. That's how to destroy a bomber should you find yourself in a World War II aircraft. I think these are fairly useful skills. And we'll let the bomber fall underneath us there, and we'll make a barrel roll over the aircraft to bleed off some excess speed. And incidentally, I don't do this in my real world flying. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed. Take care.